and welcome to the Scotichronicast, the podcast which discusses all things relating to medieval Scotland. I'm your host, Dr. Kate Buchanan. This is episode 2, and I am honored to be joined by Dr. Katy Jack. Welcome to the Scotichronicast.
Thank you. It's great to be here.
Yeah, I'm very excited to have you on this episode. Would you like to tell the listeners a little bit about yourself?
Sure. I am Dr. Katy Jack. Obviously, I'm a freelance academic. Medieval Scottish history is my poison. And I am currently a duty manager at Falkland Palace and Garden with the National Trust for Scotland. So that's my 9-to-5, then academia on the side. Can it ever be on the side? I don't know. But it is for now. Yeah. Mostly working academia once every 6 months.
Yes. I understand that.
Yeah.
Something you keep, yes, hidden away for special occasions.
Exactly, yeah. The odd conference when somebody says, this would be good, and you spend an inordinate amount of money just to keep your hand in, just to let people know that you're still alive and kicking.
Still there.
Yeah. And then you just fade into the darkness for another 6 months.
Constant Meanwhile, battle. Collecting a pile of articles that you're like, I'll have time to read that later.
Honestly, the bookmark list on my computer is growing by the day, and it's just going to get ignored. I don't know why I bother.
Yep. I have saved like the bookmarks on Twitter and the equivalent on like Facebook and like Instagram or whatever, that's just like growing and growing.
Yes.
And saved articles on academia.edu and all of this, but I'm like, I will read that as I star it and then forget about it.
Yep. And it's only when you're clearing it out about 3 years after you first start it. And you're like, wow, yeah, I don't even know why I saved that. Why is that interesting? Delete. It's a whole cycle.
And then some of them you're like, why didn't I read that already? This is so amazing.
That could have informed my entire thesis in that article I did. Like, nope. Mm-mm.
Yeah.
Too late.
Exactly. Ah, yes. The trials of having a day job and being an academic.
Absolutely.
At the same time.
Yeah. Oh, my goodness.
I don't think I've actually ever asked you, Katy, how you came to study medieval history. We just kind of like met as we were studying it together, and I don't think I ever had that conversation with you.
I don't think it's funny, actually. When I was thinking about this before I came into it, it occurred to me that I'd never really tried to chart the journey. You know how it is when you're looking back on how you've gotten from A to B. You tend not to think about it. It's just a series of events that have led you to where you are just now. So I really sat and I thought about this. Because I grew up in the Middle East, we moved to Saudi Arabia when I was about 5, I think. And I went to an international school there. And they had such, like, once we'd gotten into kind of secondary school, once it was kind of, you know, I was about 11 years old, 12 years old. We started doing the ancient Egyptians in history class.
Oh, yeah.
I was absolutely obsessed. I don't know what it is about ancient Egypt. It blows my mind. And that stuck with me for a long time. You know, I kind of came back, you know, to the UK. I went to boarding school and I thought, this is what I'm going to do. I'm going to go into this boarding school in Keswick and, you know, it's going to be fantastic. They're going to be doing all these amazing topics like ancient Egypt.
Yeah.
Maybe they'll do Greece. It's going to be wonderful.
Ooh.
They didn't.
No,
it was awful, honestly. When I think back, I think I expected, even just being in an English school, I thought they would teach you some English history. I think even something older. They didn't. It was all very much Prohibition in America, the New Deal, I think, the Cold War, all this.
Interesting.
Which was, don't get me wrong, history is history. It's fascinating. You know, I love the subject, but I think it just didn't really spark my interest the same.
Yeah, it doesn't really resonate.
No, absolutely not. But the teachers were great. And I think that, you know, I know that when I speak to a lot of people and I ask them that same question of how did you get into history? How did you get into this topic, that topic? A lot of them always come back to having those excellent teachers at school that really fired up their imagination or gave them a good report card or just were generally quite encouraging at a young age.
Right.
Which I think you just,
yeah,
you still get now, I think, but I hear less of it, which makes me quite sad.
Yeah.
And I think that's just the stresses of the system. I genuinely think that that's just because you're trying to do so much. The classes are much bigger now.
That's true.
And, you know,
it's a lot more administrative demands.
Yes, absolutely. And I think because of that, you're stretched and you still try and have that connection with the students, but it's not always possible. I know that. But we did the history and I got some lovely, lovely feedback from one of my teachers, Mrs. Richardson, I think, when I was a year 10. And I did it for GCSE because obviously I was down there and I was doing GCSEs, which led to A-levels. And she said, oh, you're very empathetic. Mm-hmm. You know, you have this great empathy with people from the past, which stuck with me. I've still got that report card. You know, I've burnt all the rest of them. They're gone. Like, I don't need to be reminded of how awful I was at maths. I don't need to see it anymore. But I've got this one, just this one. I might put it in a frame just to keep, where somebody finally said something nice. I thought, this is lovely. It's just, and I think I've kept that. You know, I didn't actually study history at A-level. I went straight off and did English, design technology, so making things out of wood, or weird plastic toothbrushes. Don't even ask, it was really it's just really bizarre. I'm still not entirely sure what the purpose of it was. I didn't do that well, probably because I questioned the entire process.
Hidden talent here.
Absolutely. Yeah, I'm just like, wow, Katie, what were you doing with your life? And drama. I did some drama and I think, yeah, English and drama and design technology. And I did, don't get me wrong, I enjoyed it. Music, I did music as well. That was a travesty. Just the worst decision I ever made. But I think at that point I thought drama would probably be the way I wanted to go because I was quite more loud than anything else. I've realized now that there's a difference between actually wanting to do drama and just being a very loud person. The two don't always go together. And I thought for a while, I thought maybe I'll do Egyptology. You know, I thought I can do this. I hadn't studied it since I was like 10 years old. Absolutely no experience or basis in this topic to decide to take this to university level. But I thought, actually, no, you can't seriously take this forward. So I thought, well, actually, I've been abroad for so long and I've been at boarding school in England for so long that it might be nice to just get in touch with Scottish history. You know, I've always enjoyed it. I did fall victim to the Braveheart curse. You know, I still love it. I still love it. It is filled with inaccuracies. I completely understand it. But do I still play the freedom speech to my students whenever I get the privilege to teach? Yes. Yes, I do. Because it fires up a room and they love it. And it just gives you such a great board to spring from to discuss other stuff. But that's a whole other story. But I think I was like, yes, Scotland, I'm going to study Scottish history. And then I failed all my A-levels just because I didn't really like the topics I was doing. But obviously that's a barrier then to getting into university, to fail all of your exams. You know, I got two Ds, a U and an E, but it's spelled dude. So I was kind of all right with that.
That's all right.
Yeah, I take that with me. I'm going to hold that as a badge of honour. And then I went to college and I thought, that's fine. I'll just do this again. I did history. But again, it was more Irish history, which is strange. I thought, I'm never going to learn the history of the country that I'm studying in. This is this is the pattern. I see it now. That's fine. I'm okay. I'm going to have to make my peace with it.
It's like this treat that's being like dangled in front of you. As
it really is. I thought, it's fine. I'm glad that I'm learning about these, you know, such important events in Ireland, but also I would love to talk about Scotland just for a lesson, just once. That's fine.
Yeah.
But I did get to Stirling University eventually and started my undergraduate in Scottish history. And I think it's kind of just, gone on from there. I was determined from year one that I would do a PhD. Obviously didn't think that I was going to ever get to the PhD because I don't really try very hard, as my mother will attest. I'm more of a fly by the seat of your pants kind of person, and I'm sure if I actually committed myself I could probably do more with my life is what she keeps telling me, you know, but it's stuck. So I think that's how I stuck with that anyway. That's how I got to that point, and then the rest is history.
Yeah.
Pun intended.
Yeah, so you did everything at Stirling, right?
Yes, I did. I'm part of the furniture. And... she says, having not been there in quite some time, actually.
Oh, right. I was going to say, except that the furniture had been removed. Right?
Yeah, probably. Thrown out. Yeah, out. It's gone.
Promoted. Mm-hmm. Promoted out.
Oh, that's. I'm absolutely going to go with that. That's much better for my ego. Yes, thank you.
So, yeah, so you studied. Your undergraduate there. What did you look at for your PhD?
It all stemmed from my undergrad dissertation. Actually, I kind of, you know, when you get that email, I think it's maybe third year before you go into honours, and they tell you that you have to pick some people that you want to go and see about possible topics that you want to study. And I just mm-hmm. finished doing a course with Professor Richard Oram on mm-hmm. Death, Disease and Famine.
Ah, yes.
Such a good course. I really miss it. I've always wanted to teach on it, and I'm never, ever lucky enough to be drafted in to teach it. But that's fine. I'm going to make my peace with that, my very bitter peace. Yep. But it was one of those things that he talked about, the cult of death, and all these wonderful, obviously sad, but wonderful ideas about, you know, imagery and death and responses to death, and these, you know, it's a really cheery topic, obviously. Yeah, absolutely. And I kind of thought, okay, that's a route that I could go down. So I'll approach Richard Oram and I'll ask him what he thinks about that. But then I also wanted to approach Alistair Ross. Mm-hmm. And I think I had some weird airy fairy ideas about looking at myths in Scotland. I think I might have even mentioned the Loch Ness Monster in my email. Right. Not entirely sure where he was going. Like, I don't know if I thought seriously that he would appreciate that as a topic. I hadn't ever really met him. I just knew that I'd had a lecture by him on something environmental.
Right.
I thought, hey, maybe he'll do myths. Like, sure thing. And something about Mary Queen of Scots, the obvious, because
of course
I think you all have to
Mary
go through
Queen
a phase
and the Loch Ness Monster.
Yes, like, exactly. I was like, I'll do anything, you know, like, give me something to do, you know. It can be Mary, it can be monsters, I can do anything, I'm versatile. But I thought, it's fine, I'll go to Richard first. So kind of marched into his office with all the confidence of an undergrad who didn't really know what they were doing. Mm-hmm. And I mean, you know yourself with Richard. It was an intense conversation for an undergrad. It was, you know, he was straight in there with, this is what your deadlines would be. You know, tell me why you want to study this subject. You know, what is it that interests you? How are you going to approach it? What's your... And I was like, oh, man. Like, I just thought it sounded cool. Like, wow. You're super smart and awesome. I'm not prepared for this. As I left, I phoned my mother and broke down into tears.
Oh, no.
But not because, and this is the thing, not because Richard himself was mean or that he put me off the subject at all. I think it was just that way of having someone treat you with the respect to challenge you enough.
Right.
Just treating
Feeling
you
a
like
bit
a
overwhelmed.
Student. Yeah. He was treating me like a student should be, you know, challenged on their ideas. It's, you know, how do you propose this going? What do you want to do? Because obviously you're using his time as well as your own. So it has to be this mutually beneficial relationship. And I think that it's one of the things that I value the most now that we're friends and kind of sometimes colleagues on projects. It's one of the things that I love going to him with an idea so that he can be like, yeah, but why? Why would you say that? Why would you? Because I'm like, good, I need you to call me out. If this is rubbish, please tell me. Like, tell me before I go any further. So I thought, that's fine. You know, wiped the tears, you know, had a pint of ice cream, and then went over to Alistair Ross, and he was like, straight away, yeah, monsters and Mary, absolutely not. Just forget about it. I was like, cool, all right. Well, I'm open to anything, because I thought, I genuinely just love the notion of Scottish history so much. I will study anything. as long as it's got enough for me to go on. I mean, I'm not fantastic at research. I'm honestly grateful every day that I managed to get a PhD, but it's like, it's hard. It's really hard work. It doesn't come naturally to me.
Yeah.
I don't think actually research, I'd be surprised if it comes naturally to anybody having to slog through
I was gonna say, it is a hard process. It's not something that's easy for anyone.
I think it's why it takes so long. It's that sheer determination to just do it. I think he had said, you know, he reached down. He always seemed to have a drawer just to his right hand side. He always just pulled an article out of, or a book, or a topic. And he was like, I tell you what, I've got this family in the Northeast, the Gordons. The Gordons of Huntly. And I thought, okay, cool, never heard of them. What's their chat, you know? And he said that they're obviously politically important. There's a lot of stuff here. Would you be interested? I thought, yeah, actually, lordship and politics, I am really interested in it. I was actually better at politics than I was at history at university, but naturally, making life easy for myself, I decided to ignore politics and go for history.
You want the challenge.
Well, exactly. This is it. I mean, come on. I thought you need to put obstacles in your own way sometimes just to give yourself something to do. So I thought, that's fine. I'll do the Gordons. And then as we got to Masters, you know, because it was always that elusive when I was like, oh, Alistair, do you think I'll get to Masters? And he was like, yeah, we'll wait and see. Yeah, well, let's just wait and see. And I was like, okay, thanks for the vote of confidence. But, you know, it's good. You know what he's like. And we got to Masters and he was like, oh, back to the mystery drawer. Pulled out the Forbes family. Oh, well, actually, they competed with the Gordons. Yeah, it's really cool. You should maybe look at that. I was like, wow, that's amazing that he just has these topics to hand. Oh, wow. And then obviously, as I got to the PhD and I was like, Alistair, what am I going to do? Like, I can't make these studies into a PhD. And he's like, it's funny you should ask that. Back to the drawer. He was like, the Earldom of Mar. Let's do the Earldom of Mar. And I was like, wow, that's really cool. How did you come up with that? He was like, well, the Gordons and the Forbes has actually had a lot of interest in this area. And I was like, oh, I've been played. That's cool. Yeah. That's all right. Like, you've planned my entire future. Like, cheers.
Yeah, you just had a file.
Yeah, exactly. I was like, wow, you had me picked from the minute. As soon as I walked in the door, obsessed with Mary Queen of Scots, he was like, absolutely not, I've got a PhD in here. So it was, yeah, I mean, it's, honestly, I can't even thank him enough. This is what's so kind of sad about the fact that he's not with us anymore, I think, is that I think he knew.
Yeah.
But it's that way that everything I do now, I mean, my obsession with some of the figures that I came across in my thesis, which I'm sure we'll come across at some point in the conversation, that all of these things that I wouldn't have come across or become obsessed with in a very healthy way. Like, if he had not just steered me in the right direction.
Right.
And I think that it was just that way that it was fated that, you know, I went in and he just had it and he had a topic there. And I think having that open mind of, I will study literally anything you put in front of me. You know, the cult of death was cool, but I don't think I could have maintained an interest in it. And I'm so grateful to Richard for pushing me on that, because I think he knew that I had come fresh off his course. I was fired up about death. And then he was like, yeah, I don't think he's going to want to do this for like an entire subject. There's nowhere to go with this. So I'm so grateful to him for actually calling me out on it and being like, you need to really think about this. And then for Alistair to just be like, well, that's cool. What about this?
Think about this.
Yeah, let's do this. Let's not do monsters and queens. So yeah, I think that that's how I got to that. And I think that it's taken on a life of its own, honestly. And because it's lordship and it's politics and it's even still relevant now, you're still looking at how family politics plays into decisions and things like that. So it's just a never ending learning curve, I think.
Right. Yeah. No, it's, the politics of Scotland is so, you think it's not going to be complicated because you're like, oh, Scotland is a much smaller country than like England or France or some of the other like bigger countries in medieval history, important countries in medieval history. Not that Scotland isn't important, it is. And that's part of the, like, when you're studying it, you're like, oh, but it's this country that's like so interconnected with like all these other countries. And because it's so small, those connections are more important, and like suddenly you open this giant can of worms. Ugh. Like global, and
you're so like, oh, many man. Worms. There's just so many worms. Like it's just, and you're so right. You get like lulled into this false sense of security, I think. Because I think even when you are Scottish and you live in Scotland, you do have this idea of it being a very small place. I mean, you know, we yeah. know that we're not on the same level as England or France, you know, Spain, any of these major kind of powers. I know that in my head. Like, I mean, I'm not very good at geography, she says, having done like lordship and having to look at the geography of it. Well, that's fine. We'll come to that later. But I think, you know, in my head, I was like, Scotland's a lovely place. It's got a lot of open space. There's some sheep up north. We're very small. Yeah. There can't be much politics to deal with here. It's just going to be a nice family study. And then all of a sudden, like you said, you open one book and you're hit with this yeah. rich tapestry of murder and deceit and romance and art. And oh, it's just, yeah, it's mind blowing.
Yeah, it's everything. Yeah. And yeah, you've got, yeah. so many like allegiances that then like change overnight, and then you're like, okay, well, we have to figure out how this, you know, results in all these like new connections. And
yeah, I think it is, it's more that it's concentrated perhaps because it's in a smaller area, and because there's not,
yeah,
you know, there's only various like sources of land that they can all compete for, and kind of positions of power. So I think everything just takes on a little bit more of a frantic kind of edge.
Yeah, all the pieces of the puzzle yeah. become way more important, as yes, it were.
Absolutely. And I think it just makes it even more, I would love to say enjoyable, but actually mostly frustrating that we just don't have a lot of sources.
So I know, it's so heartbreaking sometimes, heartbreaking and incredibly frustrating.
Yes,
because you're like, oh, this like brilliant idea for this research that I have that would be amazing to look into, and I'm sure there are sources for this. Yep. I'm sure there are. People couldn't have just not written about it.
And, lo and behold, yeah,
I'm sure there were sources for it.
Yeah, but there aren't anymore.
They probably, I don't know, got burned. Or they were, you know, drowned with a boat.
Yep.
Or burned again.
As they were drying. Yeah, no problem. That's fine. It's just, I mean, you look at it sometimes. And I mean, there's an incredible freedom to that, don't get me wrong, to having that kind of, that license not to tell lies or make things up, good Lord, but to have that way that you can say it could have been this. You know, they might have right. been wanting to do this, or they might have been wanting to do it. And I think that's what keeps Scottish history alive, and it keeps it going, is because we can't actually know if it's true or not until we find more evidence. Half the things we say we hope are true, and we're basing it on as much information as we can. But somebody could come along in 10 years and read a document entirely differently to how we do now and suggest another 6 or 7 different possibilities. I think that's what's so brilliant about
exactly.
it.
Exactly, yeah.
But, you know, it's hard not to be jealous of the English sources, you know, when you can do an entire thesis on one parliamentary role. You're like, oh, what's yeah. like?
The completeness of, yeah, the sources. Oh. And you're just like, oh, you mean you actually have records from this, like, minor noble
yeah.
family and their estate that date back to, you know, the 13th century?
Oh, yeah, like.
We have a document.
Yep. You're like, there's probably a good 10 years in our, like, crown records that we don't know anything about. Like, right. dark period. Like, blind to progress. Not a clue. But that's okay.
Nothing happened.
Mm-mm, nope, I'm just going to ignore yeah. it. Like, it never happened.
Right, exactly. There's nothing going on down here.
Absolutely
nothing. Nothing at all. Obviously nobody wanted anybody to know what was happening here.
Well, exactly. Super secret, very sneaky, not for our eyes. That's okay. I appreciate secrecy uh-huh. when it's necessary.
Mm-hmm. Oh yes, it can be a struggle. And then one thing I didn't expect is like the variety of like language mushing that happens yes. in medieval Scottish sources.
Honestly.
You're like, oh, it'll be Latin. Or it'll be French.
Yep.
Or it'll be Scots. And you're like, okay, that's, you know, can handle that. Maybe German. German is also, you know, common around then, but, you know, whatever.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Nope.
I wasn't anticipating the, like, mashing of all of them together in one document.
Oh, the honestly, it's just the sheer... I honestly think that they need to have, like, an NHS page for it. It's this, it's the specific kind of headache that you get from looking at a Scots document. Just anything from the medieval period, honestly. I mean, I know you'll have done the same, where you take these kind of Latin classes. I think it was mostly ecclesiastical Latin. I think we had David McComish, I think, and he was phenomenal, honestly, such a phenomenal tutor. And by the end of it, I was making these wonderful sentences about disciples and bishops. And and I thought, I can totally handle this. Like, throw me a document, guys. I am so on it. And then you go in, and actually the Scots are just like, we have our own Latin. Like, we just didn't want to bother with that. It's like, wow, okay, that's cool. What do you mean? Like, have you written it down? Like, is there a dictionary? Like,
yeah.
No.
No.
Like, that's fine. So I think it's just, I absolutely agree with you. This, mishmash, that's the best word for it.
Yeah. And you're just like, oh, somebody was sitting there and was like, I'm writing this in Latin. And I was like, I don't know how to say this in Latin, but I do know how to say it in French. So I'm just going to write it in French. And then I'm going to carry on with Latin.
Yep.
Like nothing happened.
Yep.
And you're sitting there, like, trying to decipher the handwriting.
Yes.
Trying to figure out, how does this Latin make sense? And then finally you realize, oh, it's French.
Yeah, that's why.
I see.
Yeah. And I just, you know, I look at...
Let's try to weave this in there.
Yeah. And you honestly, and you start to think, oh, what's the symbolism of this? Did they do this on purpose? Did they change? Was there a reason? Did they know somebody in France that they had to, is this a message? And then you're like, No.
Right.
They just put it in. Like, don't read too much into it. You need to move on. The library's shutting soon. Let's go.
Yeah.
It's just, honestly,
exactly.
I think it was a place name, actually. We were coming across a place name, and I thought, Mount of Roses. I thought, we must have some weird site somewhere in Scotland. It's a mountain of roses. Have you heard of it? It's just really cool. Like, I've come across it, and they're like, yeah, Montrose. And I was like, wow.
Yep.
That's cool, thanks. Bubble is officially burst. Actually, it's just Montrose. Stand down. And I thought, I can't believe I've wasted an entire day on this. I mean, it's beautiful.
Right.
But unnecessary.
Yeah.
So, yeah, that's the bane. The bane of every medieval life in Scotland.
Yes. Have you had a chance to do any research since your PhD much?
I've done bits and pieces. I mean, I think if you ask anybody that has seen me on the conference circuit in the past, kind of, God, when did I finish my PhD? I finished it in 2017, was when I had my viva.
Right.
And since then, I've pretty much toured with the same paper on Isabella Douglas, Countess of Mar. She's the only female countess that I deal with in my thesis. I think because I thought I was going to be talking about men, you know, earls and the Earldom of Mar. That was the title of my thesis. And I think subconsciously I thought I'll be dealing with men because it's primarily from a male point of view that you have this experience with Scottish history. It's just the way it is. It's not, you know, it's just the sources are written from a male point of view. We don't really know much about the women, although we're getting there. We're starting to see more, I think. But Isabella just came out of nowhere. And she's just such a phenomenal character, and I am low-key obsessed with her. And I just wanted everybody to know, and I kind of wanted to say, like, you know, I found this woman. Have you seen her? Like, she's super rad. Like, have you seen her though? And they're like, yeah, I mean, we came across her. She got married to Alexander Stewart, like son of the Wolf of Badenoch, like that Isabella. I was like, yeah, she's like super cool. And they're like, yeah, like, I kind of see it, but you know, I'm not really with you. So I've spent the past kind of 4 years since finishing showing people that she is worth looking at. And I did get asked in my viva, you know, I was lucky enough that I had a lovely viva with Steve Boardman and Michael Penman. And they'd kind of asked, I think they were, I don't know if they were scared to like poke the bear when they asked me the question, because I'd written so vehemently in my thesis about how wonderful she was. And I was on my soapbox in most of it. And I think even Alistair at one point was like, do you think you could just like step it down a bit? Because it feels like you're on a soapbox burning your bra. And I was like, oh, okay, yeah, no. Like, I'm just going to leave it. Okay, I'm going to leave it in. And he was like, okay, fair dues, your thesis, no problem. So that was nice of him to give me the freedom to be extreme in my views. But I think when they had asked, they were like, yeah, do you not think you're reading a bit much into her documents? We only have a small pool of evidence. And I kind of felt at that point that if you don't push the boundaries and read a bit too much into it and try and give her the same credit I would give her if she was a man, then she wouldn't ever have had the time on stage that she deserves, if you know what I mean. I think because we can so easily read into how an earl conducts his business on the same paucity of sources that it felt so strange to me that because she was a woman, we couldn't afford her the same treatment. You know, that
just
I couldn't
kind of dismiss.
Yeah, exactly. It was just like, well, do you really think they had that much agency as women? And I was like, yes, actually, there are quite a few examples now of, you know, women and female lordship in Scotland that's really starting to come out of the woodwork. And I think that that's important to contribute to that. So I thought, right, well, I'm going to tour with this paper, always from a different viewpoint, because she's so versatile. I mean, she's done so much for me. Lovely Isabella.
Yeah.
But that's mostly what I've been working on. I've just finished the Oxford Dictionary of National Biography entry for her.
Oh, excellent.
So that's great. They've done a whole series on medieval women, which is excellent. I'm just delighted to be a part of it. And that really came off the back of a conference that we went to on the kind of, like women and architecture and looking at how their history is often ignored. So it's, it's fascinating. I think there is so much there, but I think that at some point as well, I do need to look into my thesis, which it was remarked in the Viva that it was maybe like a lot of theses are, that it was less of a book already. You know, some people are just so lucky that they already have a book, you know, they have their thesis. It's already in a format that would work with a book. I'm jealous of them, and I will be until the end of my days.
Me too.
Oh, I mean, how they did it, I don't know, but I just, mine never worked out like that. It just, you know.
I think they really had to go in with the idea that that is what they're doing. They're producing the book. They're not producing the thesis.
And
I definitely did not have that idea. And this thesis is never going to be a book.
No.
Well, a part of it might eventually surface into a book.
I mean, do you prefer that? Do you like that idea that you have more freedom to take it apart, or do you find it more difficult that you then have to think about how to separate it?
Well, as far as on the research front, I definitely like the thesis being the thesis, because I think you have a freedom to do much more thorough research, and you don't necessarily have to curb yourself on like, oh, is this, you know, an appealing read, or, you know, you obviously it needs to be readable. But you don't have to necessarily have the same sort of consciousness of an audience or a need for a stronger narrative. Like you can really buckle down and focus on the facts in a way that you can't necessarily with a book, or if you are doing it with a book, you have to be much more cognizant of how this is portrayed to the audience, and making sure that it all fits in a nice narrative. And I mean, I like the freedom of having that. It is awkward though to then have that and then be, you know, requested to like then turn that into a book later. And most of the time it doesn't happen.
Yeah.
But I personally think that's okay. Of course, I'm not on the whole like bandwagon of like, you have to publish as much as possible. I mean, I understand the academia feels that, I mean, that's the culture in academia right now, and the pressure for publishing as much as you can is definitely there and a part of our lives. But I very much think that people are happier when they publish what they want to publish and when they're ready to publish it.
Yes.
And yeah, so from the perspective of needing to publish a lot in order to succeed within academia, which I think is incredibly unfortunate. Having done your thesis as ready published is a great idea.
Yes.
But from the like the actual process of learning to be a researcher, I think having the thesis is just a regular, you know, thesis gritty piece of research is actually better for the learning process.
Yes, absolutely. I think that's the thing. I don't think we get, not that we don't get enough credit or even that we don't give ourselves enough credit, I think, for even just producing something that big in the first place.
Yeah.
I think, you know, when I look back on it, you know, on everyone, I mean, I know that obviously you were still doing your PhD as I was starting mine. I think you were coming towards the end, I think, of yours. And I was looking at how big yours was. Yes. Yeah. And I thought, you know, and I kept looking and I was like, I'm never going to have something like that. Oh my God, look how much work she's done. Look at that. And they were like, yeah, you're going to have that and you're going to have to do some editing. And I was like, don't be ridiculous. Like, I can barely write a 5,000 word essay. That's obscene. And then you just, it grows. It grows and grows and grows. And it becomes this untamable beast that you then have to kind of whittle down and, you know, read until your eyes are bleeding. And you think, actually, do you know what? I don't care if this is book ready. I'm just happy I have a contents page that actually fits the pages. Just take it. Get it away from me. And I think
I had nicknamed my thesis Sweetums, because you know the Muppet that is like this giant, like shaggy, like monstrosity of a Muppet, but he's like so nice.
That's the best thing I've ever heard. Nice. Oh, it just has such a nice ring to it.
Yeah, and there's like this random file in all of my like backups and stuff that's Sweetums, and I'm like, if somebody ever has to like go in here that's not me, is gonna be like, what is this?
Like, what happened here? Like, what's going on? Well, that's, I think when you look, I mean, I think you can tell a lot from our kind of mental state as we go through the PhD from our save file names.
Yeah.
They start off very nice, you know, first draft and this is a good one. And then it slowly descends into the final, which I think I had sent to Ben, obviously Ben Fanstone. He read through it and did all my maps for me. And I mean, what a joy he is to be around. I don't know what I would have done without him and Helen Young to just to help me do it and get me through it. In those very final months. And the very last file that I sent to the printers was, oh my God, thank God it's over. And I just thought, they're going to open this and they're going to be like, is she okay? Like, is she okay? And I thought, I don't care anymore. Take this away from me. I want to go. I need to leave. Just don't talk to me for a month. So I think you do get to that point where I was not thinking about how it would be published and how it would be received by the academic community. At that point, I just wanted to go to bed.
Yes, you just want it done.
Yes, you just want it gone. And I think that now, obviously, yes, I think that it would have been great if I could have just turned it straight into a book. But actually, it works as a series of biographies. I kind of deal with each Earl, and Isabella gets her own chapter because she's obviously wonderful. it works as a series of articles. I think that's what Steve Boardman and Michael Pemmin had said, is that actually this would be great as a series of articles. And I think the book in the future would be looking at the impact of absentee lordship on the development of an area, like a region. Or an earldom, because I think that's what we found the most, is that the Earls of Mar, I mean, people, honestly, I tell you this hand on heart, people are so keen to have an opinion about the Earldom of Mar. I did not prepare myself for this, and Alistair did not prepare me for this, actually. Yeah. Like, this is a touchy subject. And because there are currently two Earls of Mar, or an Earl and a Countess, I should say.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, with the ancient Earldom and the modern Earldom. It's such a divisive subject. And I still get people asking me things about it, you know, which side do you come down on and how do you think this happened? And I was like, I'm just a lowly historian. I don't have any particular preferences for either of your families. Like, please don't take it personally if I come down on anyone's side. I'm just using the documents. Like, please, please.
Right.
So I think it's one of those things. It's fascinating. I mean, for as far as public engagement goes, it's really fun to think about how the documents that you're using from the 1400s actually still impact perceptions of ownership. You know, today it's brilliant. I do want to do a lot more on that because there was the whole 18th century debate on who should have been the Earl of Mar, and I think there's a lot there to really take apart and see what's in there. You know, there's some great letters that they were sending in newspapers to each other, you know, really bitter, like, kind of pieces that they were putting in the little letters at the back where they're calling each other out, and it's name calling, and it's really like down to earth gritty stuff, shouting at each other over, you know, like when they're at family funerals and shouting at each other as they're trying to bury the body. And I'm like, can you just take it inside? Like, just take it inside, guys. Wait till the wake, okay? Just simmer down. So, yeah, there's a lot there. There's so much scope. And I think absentee lordship for the Earldom of Mar, certainly, because they spend the earls and the countess, they spend so much time away from their earldom proper.
Yeah.
But it still seems to flourish, and it still seems to be regarded as one of these premier earldoms in Scotland. And I think that's just absolutely fascinating. I want to know why people are so obsessed with it and why they want to have it.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
Well, that is, that sounds really awesome and really interesting. I look forward to eventually reading or hearing more about that someday.
down the line, down this.
Yeah, yeah.
The grand plan. Things in the future. Absolutely.
Yeah. Yep. Well, thank you very much for talking with me today, Katy. This has been super fun.
Well, I'm glad. Thank you, really, honestly, for... Yeah, thank you. It's just been so nice to talk to someone about stuff.
Yeah. I know. It's nice to... That's part of what this project is all about, is like creating a space for us to just chat about things.
Absolutely.
So, yeah. Well, thank you very much. I, again, really appreciate you joining me on the podcast today.
That's great. Thank you.
Thank you for joining us on the Scotichronicast. Please rate and review wherever you get your podcasts, and be sure to subscribe so you never miss an episode. You can also follow our account on Twitter, at Scotichronicast. Our music is Ex Tulux Urtur by Gaita. Thanks for listening.